Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. We are glad to introduce one of our information security research topics on grass-level security. Our paper will be published in conference proceedings. Ideas of the presentation have been implemented in our project addressing grass-level security and U.S. State of Massachusetts personal information protection laws. While information security can be improved in a number of ways, as you see on the slide, one powerful approach is continually overlooked by security researchers. We name it grass-level security. On the slide, we present three ways of information security improvement. Vulnerability discovery can be done by an individual and requires mostly just personal drive, not too much of resources. New information protection methods require significant resources and as such are intended for large corporations, not small businesses or individuals. For instance, new security methods, new malware analysis, whatever you can imagine, but such companies like Symantec, Trend Micro, etc. Grass-level security. Computer users having minimal resources, minimal security options, and as a result, minimal protection. This constitutes a collective effort by masses of computer users, where each individual has a very limited understanding of information security and is frequently forced to improve security by various laws and regulations. Pressure coming from government side and cybercriminals affect small businesses' capability of conducting business as usual. It's questionable whether in such situation adequate security level to protect information could be achieved. This presentation is our attempt to address such gap and to analyze current status of information security processes and masses based on the situation in the United States, and to identify our ability to protect personal information through government regulatory affairs and regulations implementation. Recognize that the U.S. has a quite specific form of government, laws, and business organizations. To show how important grass-level security is, we can check for instance, recent FBI case where they shut down Estonian botnet of 2 million computers and shut down control and command center and shut down internet service providers. So they did everything. It took a couple years. However, what's going to be next if computers will be vulnerable as well, if within like a few months or and such botnet could be created within one or couple years. So on the following slide, you can see characteristics of U.S. business landscape which define U.S. security scope. U.S. is a country of small businesses, by any statistics. By available to us, 90% have less than 100 employees. In the United States, cost of opening a business could be as low as $50 for 3 years registration. Impressive, yeah? In most cases, to register a corporation is a few hundred of dollars and half an hour. Most of the businesses are not strictly regulated, and in the case of imposing regulations like information security, such regulations will be basically ignored. So it's what we name as small business psychology, strict focus only on business matters and what lies outside and required by government, ignore if it's possible. While the U.S. has numerous laws protecting personal information, two of the regulations are the most pertinent and important for our analysis. There are two federal, they are the federal HIPAA high-tech and state of Massachusetts MGL, whatever. Yeah, I will name it as 201 SEMA, SEMA regulation. This paper considers obstacles in achieving compliance with both regulations. In particular, the compliance process affects small and mid-sized businesses. Those types of businesses, by and large, do not have sufficient resources to be compliant. The situation is made even more difficult by virtue of government not providing any help to start the compliant process. On the following slide, we'll see security information model as it corresponds to the matters discussed in the presentation. Oops. Hey. There are four phases, and government controls three of them. However, the government completely excludes itself from helping in implementation of information security, considering it as a part of business process. So basically, it's old as this world, so government is to govern and business is to do business. However, it really doesn't work in our situation. Such wrong assumption deeply affects results of implementation. We found deficiencies related to government participation in three other phases. Government doesn't exactly identify rules of compliance, enforcement in regulations, which then affect two other phases, regulation enforcement and audit. Authors consider degradation of security as a result of those deficiencies in the environment and implementation in enforcement and implementation phases. Such uncertain and grim security situation can be significantly improved if government and businesses work together as a part of one implementation process and government clarified and improved enforcement process. We'll discuss certain measures of achieving a better security posture, including automation of compliance process phases at the end of presentation. So as you can see, those four steps, it's a model. It explains how entities like government and business connected together in one process. However, if a business is going to do compliance and wants to achieve compliance, then business should know regulation. It should know what is going to happen if compliance is not achieved. So it's basically enforcement regulation. Then business should do implementation, of course. And then whatever means an audit, either self-audit or external audit. In this, on this slide, we see government audit, but basically first step is self-audit. You need to know what you did. U.S. laws require protection of personal information by government organizations and private enterprises. Thus, U.S. laws are split along the government and private sector lines. We will discuss what is related to and should be implemented by private sector only, which in the U.S. is much bigger than government and thus defines security situation, as you can see on the slide, which provides data loss statistics for U.S. economy sectors, which are where businesses and medical sectors are responsible for 70% of losses. I like in particular this this table because it also shows not only that business and medical together are approximately 70% now of data losses. However, if you see third and fourth line, government is less secure than education. Education basically is considered as the most insecure environment. However, government actually supersedes. There are federal laws related to protection of personal information, where first two represent regulations as we are discussing in the presentation. HIPAA, it's Health Insurance Accountability and Portability Act, which been enacted originally in 1996 for completely different purpose. Okay. Then it was added by security rule approximately in February 2003, because it at this point being obvious that it's been obvious that security, that personal medical information requires protection. Then this law been added in February 2006 by enforcement rule, which sets civil money penalties for violations of the law. So it's been a step from previous step, 2003, because government understood compliance, business entities don't care about compliance. However, this situation continued later, and that's why high-tech health information technology for economics and clinical health act been enacted February 29. It is logical improvement to HIPAA concerning enforcement, because the required compliance was largely ignored. The law became effective in February 2010. It increases the non-compliance penalties up to 1.5 million. So it's an impressive number. And extends provisions of the law to associated businesses. It's also important, including civil and criminal penalties. It also requires notification of authorities in a case of a PHI loss. These two regulations, we consider HIPAA and related part of high-tech as one set of regulations, are the most used in the United States. There are a few others to mention, which add certain color in the legislative landscape, as you see on the slide. Two of them, GLBA and SOX, are pretty well known because they affect financial services companies, banks, insurance companies, etc. However, the rest three are pretty unknown, and we put it here just to be consistent. If anybody wants to know, and if anybody needs to get a kind of reference of entire picture of personal protection laws in the United States. However, the United States has state laws protecting personal information inside a state as well. So not just on top, also like inside a state, which in most cases address only one aspect of commerce, for instance, insurance. One exception is the state of Massachusetts, which has data breaches law and following 201 CMR standards for protection of personal information, which is presented on this slide. This is the first comprehensive state law covering almost all, approximately 99% of the state businesses. It also requires other states' businesses in possession of Massachusetts citizens' personal information to be compliant with the law. That is shocking thing, basically, because in generally, logically, this chain of responsibilities is understood. However, it's completely ignored. And on this basis, by our current, not really finished analysis, I can say that there is no one compliant company in the United States, because similar statement is in HIPAA, and basically it's ignored by all companies, but if ignored any point of legislation, then there is no compliance. It's logical, I think. Such colorful palette is also of various lores, which is already fairly confusing, has a chance to be extended by so-called Data Accountability and Trust Act, which will cover entities involved in interstate commerce. However, there are a few other acts in Congress as well. Just a few words. It's like a picture. There is another data protection law in the United States Congress, and it's there for approximately 2 years, and it's not really moving. And it's not moving inside Congress just because it's opposed by various powerful business bodies. There is only one organization which is pro this law, which is Civil Liberties Union. However, all other business entities like U.S. Chamber of Commerce and other powerful organizations are really opposing this law, which would cover entire United States territory and maybe removing this like really powerful landscape. The reality is that numerous information security laws and standards requiring compliance are confusing and basically drive businesses to ignore them. That is why the government is continually imposing additional requirements and penalties, as in high tech. Does it really help? We'll try to answer whether compliance with regulations could be achieved. What happens in the trenches when law meets with real life scenarios? Such analysis is very important because by numerous accounts, defensive side, us people in our government, and security industry is continually losing to offensive hackers, another room, okay, and the cyber criminal industry. However, the more dramatic part of the entire action is regulation enforcement. Slow consideration. This is an enormous gap between government intentions and what we see in reality. On the next slide, we return to our security implementation model, and next to each phase, we place our comments concerning its imperfection. While U.S. laws are clear in what they are proclaiming, all imperfections surface when we turn to the implementation with the final goal of improving information security by compliance. As we see on the slide, so far government is not involved and actually excludes itself completely from any activity in key implementation phase. So basically it's very, I wouldn't say easy position because writing laws is not easy, it's not easy job. However, when you ask somebody to do something and don't care if it's possible at all, you know, it's really interesting position of great project manager who just wants a job to be done and doesn't care how it's gonna be done. In our presentation, we use information from a notorious Verizon data breach investigation report of 2011. Actually, they used data from 2010 to support this research. The caseload of 2010 year is based on 667 U.S. security services cases. I actually heard information that last year, unfortunately, I haven't been here. It's my first time, hopefully not the last. A person from United States Security Services did a presentation and mentioned the same information. Now Verizon, which is internet and telecommunication services provider in the United States, pretty known, decided to join their cases and United States Security Services cases in one report where they considered various situations and used those statistics to achieve certain recommendations. Basically, as we see on, as you see on the slide, those statistics belong mostly, 96%, to the United States. Statistics which Verizon got in Europe and Asia, they're minimal. And what is said in Verizon report is basically about United States. In our presentation, we'll refer to two and the most distinguished and widely applicable personal information protection law. Now we are considering them in some details because those two regulations actually related to small businesses and affect small businesses, as we said before. Medical businesses, which should be compliant with HIPAA, are responsible for 25% of data losses in the United States since 2011. Supporting and other related businesses definitely add some value as well. Thus, such businesses are a major security concern. Medical, healthcare, and supporting businesses in the United States number hundreds of thousands and very likely outnumber any other industry. Thus, we choose HIPAA as covering business masses. You know, in the United States, if you go around, especially in suburban or small towns, vicinities, you could see a number of small medical offices, more than any other businesses like restaurants, gas stations, whatever. So basically they cover entire States territory. However, our attempt to identify exactly how many small businesses in the United States actually failed. We spent numerous time trying to get United States statistics from United States Chamber of Commerce, using Google, et cetera. It was not just possible. So this is our estimate as we present here. Massachusetts government went even further. 201 CMR covers all the state businesses together, including barbershops, restaurants, car repair, et cetera. Can you imagine at car repair shop for security compliance? Anyway, it's required. Thus, two laws and question currently regulate the most popular set of industries in one entire state. Massachusetts has more than 700,000 businesses now, and approximately 90% of them are small and medium size. We believe that in healthcare, we have a very similar situation. Most of the providers and supporting services are small and medium-sized businesses. Thus, both regulations are challenging directly small and medium-sized businesses, and they, in return, are challenging law. So it's a both way connection. That's what we're trying to say. Should we bother requiring security for masses? Our assumption is that SMB masses statistically define information security level in the United States. Our personal information is distributed between numerous businesses. There are medical offices, taxpayers, public accountants, insurance companies, finance offices, etc. However, the understanding of threats in information security is on computer malware level. For instance, like saying, I have an antivirus software and I am protected. And security implementation is limited by internet firewall supplied by a provider and having default configuration. By the Verizon report, 96% of breaches were avoidable through simple or intermediate controls. It means it doesn't require too much of efforts. It just requires patching, antivirus updated, reasonable firewall, etc. So it would resolve possibly 90% of data breaches in the United States. Penetrating such easy targets is simple, and that's why bot networks grow to millions of computers. Hijacked home and SMB computers are the foundation of major malicious activity like distribution of spam and DDoS attacks. It's obvious that breaking in and stealing information from a home office computer is much easier than from more heavily fortified banks network. Such activity will not be noticed at all until information has been used by hackers. Very low personal risk of attacking and easy of breaking in are two reasons to target SMBs. However, the main reason is the ease of making money out of stolen information. We will discuss this further in the presentation. Yesterday, you've seen beautiful presentation concerning where money goes and how security breaches like stolen passwords, et cetera, could be solved on the internet. Yes, it definitely works, but we see a rising wall of generally different money extortion cases. Which really requires our attention, and we'll discuss it later. Clear indication of switching attacks vector to SMB could be found, for instance, in Verizon report as well. The number of compromised records has been 360 million in 2008, 143 million in 2009, and finally dropped significantly to only 2.8 million in 2010 for known and investigated cases. We believe that hacking activity didn't drop. Otherwise, it means drop like 20 or 30 times in black market total income. It's not possible. So they do, and they make money in different ways. And we believe that what we're discussing at the end of the presentation is exactly this case. It means approximately of 2,000 records per incident. Very low number, by the way. It's not banks. It's like 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, or 5,000 records. Most of the data has been stolen from servers, 76%. Such small amount of data kept on servers more likely belongs to SMB rather than large business servers. Statistics from Verizon confirming that 64% of all breaches happened in organization of 100 or less employees. There is no doubt that small business entities are easy to compromise, and they are helping to distribute cyber attacks. Why still a matter of opportunity, in near future SMB could become focused spear attack targets. Having them compliant to security regulations means significantly improving information security around the country. We are moving to achieving compliance. So we're basically moving through like our model. First, regulations. Second, understanding of matters. And third is implementation. So how to achieve compliance? There are definitely information security problems out there in hundreds of thousands of businesses around the country. Before going to why, we are going to consider some numbers. 98% of VIX is subject to PCI DSS. We refer to Verizon report as well. So 89% had not achieved compliance. It means that having such such regulation is, I believe, you know, PCI DSS, which I think so international and required and dealing business, doing business with the United States and major financial institutions in the United States, companies should be compliant with PCI DSS. This is a rather unsettling number. While we don't consider PCI DSS in this presentation in particular, we can use it as an example. PCI DSS is pretty easy to implement comparing to both HIPAA and CMR. It's consistent and based on clear security controls assessment list. There are more than 200 questions, requirements, and the implementation is relatively straightforward. It's technical rather than organizational or managerial task. Implementation of HIPAA is difficult because of its high-level standards, and then the implementation itself. 201 CMR involves many fewer security controls, but has mixed nature of high and low-level technical requirements, and as such, is not easy to implement as well. So just to give a note, two laws, both protecting personal information, and one is written as high-level language, just standards, nothing else. The rest you do it yourself. Well, in Massachusetts law, I don't know why they went this way, but they did. They have high-level requirements, and at the same time, they have requirements similar, like you have to have updated antivirus software. Nice, yes, of course. Thus, having an easy implementable DSS standard, we still have only 10% of compliance rate. What should we expect from small and mid-sized businesses concerning HIPAA and 201 CMR with all their obstacles? It should be definitely less than 10, and very likely closer to 1 than 10. The reality is when Massachusetts law being enacted, we tried to start a project, and we still continue. Yeah, when we tried to start it, we discussed this matter with people of small businesses. They didn't understand it. It took approximately 1 hour per one person to explain what is going on. Okay, then they said, yeah, fine, but I don't need it. Comprehensive.
10 minutes
to go? Oops. Yeah, really? I started, I think, so 5 minutes. I started 9:05. Okay. Comprehensive information security program are a starting point of compliance. And if there is no document, there is no compliance. Development of such business and following implementation is a job for high-level security professionals, and in no case, in a way, it can be done by SMB personnel. Government efforts to enforce information security by compliance are failing simply because, first, compliance requires unusual activities and significant efforts, and second, are not compatible with SMB resources. Now we are going to prove the second part of our conclusive statement above. Let's say SMB healthcare services company wants compliance with two regulations in question. After reading both regulations, a typical IT specialist providing security services will understand little more, but then papers are very likely required. Even in the very beginning, HIPAA is not clear about the first step, and 200 CMR is clear, but pretty in the similar way. So the first conclusion is that a company of a few or a few dozen employees cannot itself implement or whatever do this regulation.
Do federal or Massachusetts government provide any help in the form of explaining such process of development and implementation, or has a resource that at least demonstrates the appearance of such document? The answer is simple, no. There are multiple internet sites selling a set of templates for policies for HIPAA standard set and WILFU set down to, for there are sets for HIPAA and also sets for 201 CMR. With 101 CMR, you would get a simple solution contained in one document. Each solution could cost around $300. It's definitely inexpensive, but requires expert-level work to finish document. Finally, time would be the same as for doing it from the scratch. That does not help either. Basically, while requiring mandatory compliance, the government does not provide any help to SMB to figure out what to do and where to start with. In the very beginning of each regulation document, the government proclaims flexibility of approach and being responsible for implementing security by considering business size, complexity, capability, technical structure, etc. Does it help at all? It leaves a business with even more questions, because it should decide what would be enough as protective measures. We paid so much attention to the beginning of this process to show that there is a hopeless situation, and that only one realistic option is available to turn to a security consulting company. There it will be explained that compliance process consists of three phases: development of set of policies, implementation policies, and assessment of compliance. Common sense dictates that a company of two people, for instance, a dental office, should get different paperwork than a company of several medical doctors with supplying staff, and definitely much less than a company of 100 personnel dealing with a lot of personal protected information. However, manual development or rewriting such policies together with implementation part for particular organization infrastructure would be very time-consuming process. More likely than the customer having no idea about what is given on and what they should be given, will get a set of basic security policies. As a result, the implementation phase will have nothing in common with what is contained in the policies, and basically will be the installation of standard security controls. Getting 201 CMR is a very similar story. The size of the final document could contain a few pages, but it's not always the case. It depends on what a vendor typically sells. On this slide, we provide you some information as our estimate, what actually is a cost of compliance. I wouldn't go to details, but the summary of this information is that we estimate as one small office would get compliance for HIPAA and 201 CMR approximately for $20,000. However, basic expectation of a medical office, like their estimate what they can spend for something, they actually don't understand what they're buying, where they're buying, and what they're buying, you know. It's basically $5,000. So is there a big difference between price of what is they expect and what they could get in reality? There is one more matter to discuss in conclusion, and which is associated with penalties as well. As mentioned above, U.S. government can punish HIPAA covered entity business up to 1.5 million, even if only one personal record has been lost. This creates enormous business risk. If a breach has happened and government is notified, and if government investigation concludes that business was negligent and in protecting the information, then it's up to the government to identify the magnitude of the fine. What does 6- or 7-digit penalty mean for a company of few people? The most likely answer is going out of business. Thus, not knowing how much a cost of breach could be, the best bet is keep silent. By this virtue, both the victim of compromise and perpetrator are on the same side. The result is silence instead of investigation. It creates perfect ground for blackmail extortion. You pay me and I'll return, delete, etc., your data. Otherwise, we will publicly notify that you lost it and you will lose your business. Tough options between being silent and the exchange of, say $50,000 for stolen data, or disclose the loss to authorities and face $50,000 or $1.5 million penalty, plus investigation costs, plus et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. How many small businesses would resist paying off and keeping silent? Okay, going down. So, how to verify compliance? It's also a question, because government doesn't provide any real document which would explain compliance process. The government just requires compliance. It means when you implemented security controls, you basically on your own how to verify them. Government has, in some cases, specific lists, but those lists are not really for compliance. They sometimes for data loss and investigation purposes. It means you can use them, but with some limitations. So I would say small and mid-sized businesses are again on their own when they need to verify compliance. Automated verification of compliance. Security vendors provide various tools to verify compliance automatically. However, our main question here is how automated verification of compliance could be done if implementation is of written policy. So basically a policy we have as written document, and then we need to verify compliance. Okay, so it's basically impossible by automatic way. We introduced on our website, there is a website underneath, specific service for companies, small businesses, it's free, which delivers automatically generated policy. Thus, using this policy, company can start compliance process. Then having our checklist, they can verify compliance, and basically it's a way for automation. So our opinion is a pilot project which actually explains our power point of view and proves our case that it's possible. This can be, we think it could be in future as real help for small and mid-sized businesses. Okay.